Welcome to the lecture series on computer organization. Today we will discuss about that means here we will design the control unit with the help of logic gates or sequential circuits. Design the control unit with the help of logic gates or in simple combinational circuits. So before designing the control unit using hardware technique, we will first discuss what is the meaning of instruction cycle. Any instruction execution, it will undergo four phases. First phase, fetch the instruction, second phase is decode the instruction, and the third one is read the effective address of the operands and fetch the operands. Fourth phase, execute the instruction. Fetch the instruction. Any instruction undergoes these four stages. First stage, fetch the instruction, decode the instruction, read the effective address of the operands, and fetch the operands and execute the instruction. Actually, here in the third stage, two operations are performed sequentially. That means this one and this one. Instruction execution is followed in four stages. In first stage, fetch the instruction is executed. That means in the fetch the instruction phase, instructions are fetched from the main memory and it is stored in IR register. In the second stage, that is decode the instruction, the IR register contents will be analyzed on bit by bit basis. We will see. In third stage, that is effective address calculation and fetch the operands. That means in third stage, address of the operands are calculated. With that address, the operands are fetched from the main memory and they are stored in data register or accumulator. So in final stage, once you decoded the opcode, once you got the operands in the register, you will perform the actual execution. So any instructions will have to undergo these four stages. In short, instruction execution is done in four stages. Fetch the instruction, instruction will be fetched in, and then in the second stage, instructions are decoded. In the third stage, address of the operands are calculated and operands are fetched. In the fourth stage, instructions are executed and the results are stored in accumulator or data register. So this is what is happening in the instruction cycle. So whatever the instruction may be, it has to follow these four stages. So by assuming these four stages, we will design a control unit. We will design a hardware circuit for the control unit. Let us see how it is possible. Before going this, we will see the block diagram of our control unit. Control unit for our basic computer. Here the basic computer means the computers which is having minimal instruction set. The minimum instruction set and its binary code are discussed in the previous lecture. Now we will see the basic control unit. The main purpose of control unit is to give the control signals to each and every part of the ALU unit and the memory units. So that is the main purpose of control unit. Or you can say as the control unit, it gives the control signals for coordination of all the components in the computer so that your user program is executed. This is, let us suppose, this is our IR register. We already discussed the length of the IR register is 16 bits starting from 0 to 15. This is I bit. This is opcode field 12, or we will write in simply. This is 15th bit, 14, 13, 12. This is our opcode. From 12 to, this is our I bit. This is our address. That means from 0 to 11. From 0 to 11, we will call it as address field. Address bit. This is what we have studied in the previous lecture. So when this instruction is brought from the main memory and it is stored in IR register, it will be analyzed bit by bit basis. That means this will be taken out separately. And this we will call it as I, and after that and the 3 bits in the opcode field are given to 3x8 decoder for decoding the instructions, and then the address, the third field from 0 to 11 are separated. you can see the separation. And the output of decoder, you will get 8 outputs starting from D0. D1 and so on up to D7. You will get 8 outputs and all are given to a combinational circuit, or we will call it as simply as a control logic circuit. And then the I input is also given to the input as control logic gate, and all these logic gates are controlled with sequential clock pulses, that is given as separately like this. I will draw with separate color. You take, let us suppose you will generate 16 clock pulses, so you will use 4 bit sequence counter. This 4 bit sequence counter, it will give the output in coded form. Coded form, and the input in coded form, it should be decoded. That means you have to use 4x16 decoder. This will give you 16 decoded output signals, which is termed as clock pulses. This is T0, this is T1, and so on up to T15. Total 16 clock pulses are generated. 16 clock pulses are given to the control logic gate. The input for bit for this 4 bit sequence counter is, these are all control inputs, clear, incrementer, and a master clock pulse. Together with all these control inputs, our control logic gates, it will generate a set of control outputs. This is the basic block diagram for designing hardware based control unit. Now our task is to design this control logic circuit. Control logic circuit. It depends upon our instruction set. We will see shortly. As of now, you should understand that how the control signals are generated with the help of control logic gate here. It takes input from different fields, from the IR register and clock signals. These control logic gates, they are designed in such a way that at the first clock cycle, fetch instruction will be performed. That means This control logic gate, it is designed in such a way that each instruction undergoes four stages. First stage, fetch the instruction. In second stage, decode instruction, and then address calculation, and finally execute the instruction. Our control logic gates, it will make sure that it will generate the control signals or control outputs, so that at appropriate timing instances, the fetch instruction is executed and decode the instruction is executed. That means your control unit generates the control signals, which is responsible for doing this instruction, fetch the instruction. In second stage, again this control logic, it generates control signals so that the instruction will be decoded. Again, at third stage, this control logic, it will generate the address calculation and then fetch the operand operation automatically by giving control signals, so that this stage is performed. Likewise, in fourth stage, this control logic gate, it gives output signals for executing the instruction. So each control signal, it will trigger a set of logic circuits, so that each stage is performed independently. So the activation of these four stages, it depends upon the output of the control logic gates. How to generate the control signal, when to generate the control signal, it depends upon the logic gates, combinational circuits here. This is we have to design. This design, it depends upon our instruction set, which is designed in the previous class. So your computer, it doesn't know anything. It doesn't know the opcode. It doesn't know the instruction. It doesn't know data, nothing. Just depending upon the stage that the instruction is present, your computer or control unit, it will interpret a binary information as instruction. If it is stage 3 means, it will be interpreted as data or address. The fourth stage, executions were executed, and the results are again stored in the intermediate registers. So depending upon the timing signals generated by this decoder and the control signals, your control unit, it will interpret the data in different formats. So once you understand that, we can easily go to the next topic. Once you understand, now our task is to design the control logic gates, which is responsible for performing all these four stages one by one. Now take the first stage, that is fetch the instruction. For fetch the instruction, let us write the micro operation involved in that. Fetch instruction. For this fetch instruction, we already discussed our timing circuits. It will generate 16 clock pulses starting from T0, T1 and so on up to T15. After completion of T15, again T0 will be generated, T1 up to T15. This cycle will be repeated. Since our instruction execution has to start this phase, first phase, you should always execute at T0 clock cycle. At T0 clock cycle, you have to fetch the instruction. At T0 clock cycle, you have to fetch the instruction. We already discussed that. Fetch the instruction. That means at this stage, the content of PC should be brought to the address register. We already discussed that. The PC contains the address of the next instruction. So the content of PC, it should be moved to the address register. When you move a particular address in the address register, automatically the next start place will be instructed. So during the fetch, the instruction phase, we have to bring the instruction. Since we have to bring the instruction from memory, what you have to do means, you have to first of all store the address from PC to AR. That is the first micro operation you have to perform from PC to AR. This is the, at first clock pulse, you have to transfer the data of PC into AR. Because if you don't know the address, you cannot fetch the instruction. So, for performing the fetch the instruction phase, first of all, the address should be transferred. Initially, the address is present in PC. So, it should be transferred to the address register. This is what is happening in the first clock pulse. During next clock pulse, the memory location should be accessed with the help of address register and it should be brought into the instruction register. That is a next micro operation we will perform. M of ER. Whatever the address that is referenced by address register, it will be brought into IR register, and after that the contents of PC is incremented by 1. That means it points to the next instruction. After performing these 3 micro operations, this stage will be concluded. The first stage will be over. That means in the first stage, you need to execute 3 micro operations. First one is at first clock cycle, PC content should be transferred to AR. At next clock cycle, the memory content, memory location is accessed and it is stored in IR. And then PC is, next micro operation is PC is incremented by 1. So by doing these 3 micro operations at T0 and T1 clock pulse respectively, we will complete the fetch the instruction phase. So roughly we will draw the logic circuit for this. Let us see how it is possible. So I think for implementing these 3 micro operations, you need memory, PC, AR, IR. Is it right? Right. you need one memory unit, memory one memory memory unit, address register, and one PC register. PC register and IR register. IR register. Now what we have to do? We all know that all are connected with the help of common bus. For this common bus, we will have a bus controller for selecting the components. We already studied this. S2, S1, S0, S2, S1, S0. ARPC. Now we will take one by one. For first micro operation, what we have to do means you have to activate the PC contents, you have to place the contents of PC, you have to place the contents of PC onto the bus. At the same time, you have to activate the load input of address AR address register. You have to select the PC register, that means you have to place the content of PC onto the bus. How it is possible means with the help of activating the S2, S1, S0 control pin, you can place the content of PC onto the bus, and then from the bus you have to transfer the content to AR. This should happen at T0 clock pulse. That means for PC, the address is very simple thing. Let us assume this address for address history is 1 and the address is binary representation is 2. Let us suppose 3. So your T0 should be connected to like this. At T0 clock pulse, it should trigger, since we need to trigger PC. For PC, the binary value is 2. We need to give something like this, 010. You can give the input T0 to S1. So by doing so, when our T0 is 1, S1 will be 1 and S0, S2 will be 0. So thereby the PC content will be activated. The content of PC will be activated and it is placed onto the bus. At the same time, you need to activate the load content of AR. So we already studied load pin is there. So the load, the T0 is connected to load pin. Similarly, at T1 clock pulse, you need to select the memory. You need to select the memory unit. That means then only you will place the content of memory unit onto the bus. And then at the same time, you need to activate the load pin of IR at T1 clock pulse. So for memory unit, what is the address we have given? Let us suppose it is 6. 6 means, what is the binary representation? 6 or 7. 7 you can see, no problem. This is just for our case only. Let us suppose it is 7. So the T1 input, T1 given input should be given to S0 and S2. This should be given to S1. Since already T0 is connected, so you place a OR gate like this. You place a OR gate. Multi input OR gate. Multi-input OR gate like this. So after selecting the memory unit, the content of memory unit will be placed onto bus. You will have a connection like this also. In memory, you will have two control pins. One is read, and that is write. For simplicity, I am writing here. So at T1, you need to read the data from the memory. So you need to give another control input from T1. You take this input and you give the clock pulse to read input. This is read control pin of memory. At T1 clock pulse, you performed the read operation. Simultaneously, you have to perform the write operation onto IR. That means you need to activate at T1 clock cycle. That means you take the input from T1 clock cycle, you can take from here, and then you give to the load pin. So that completes the first micro operation at T1 clock cycle. At the same time, you need to perform the increment operation for PC. Therefore, this T1 clock cycle, you take this input and you give to the increment pin of the PC, increment. By doing so, we will achieve the operations corresponding to T0, T1. So it is a very simple logical circuit for doing the fetch the instruction phase. We have to define the micro operations at each clock pulse. At each clock pulse, you have to draw the logic diagram like this and you have to solve. So this is how the fetch the instruction phase is designed. Now we will draw the flow chart for program execution. Flow chart for program execution. First, the sequence counter is initialized with 0 and then at T0 clock cycle, the content of PC will be stored in address register and then at T1 clock cycle, memory instruction is stored in IR. At the same time, PC is incremented by 1. This will happen at T1 clock cycle. In next phase, instruction decoding will happen. That means the content of first 12 bits of IR register is transformed to AR and then the 16th bit of is IR register is stored in I. This is called decoding. At T2 clock cycle, will perform decoding of that. Next comes the operand address calculation. Before calculating the operand address calculation, we have to find what type of instruction it is, whether it is a memory reference instruction or register or input output instruction. For that, we will check the decoder output D7. This D7 is present here. If the D7 bit is 0, we will call it as memory reference instruction. If D7 is equal to 1, then we'll call it as register R IO instruction. Because we have designed in the binary code assignment like that only. Let us suppose first we will go for the register R IO instruction. After finding D7 is equal to 1, we will find that it is belonging to register instruction or IO instruction. Now again you will check the I bit. This I bit is the 16th bit of IR register. 16th bit of IR register, and you have to check. If I is equal to 1, then we will call it as IO instruction. For IO instruction at T3 clock cycle, IO instruction means it is very simple. At T3 clock cycle, simply you will execute the input output instruction. Here we will assume that, for simplicity, we will assume that the data is available in input output registers. So we will directly execute the IO instruction, but in actual it is not like that. We have to check the status of INPR register input output flags. Based on that flag only we have to execute the IO instruction. For simplicity, in this flowchart we will write as at T3 clock cycle we will execute the IO instruction. If I is equal to 0, that is, it is a register instruction, at T3 clock cycle you will execute the instruction. Since the data is available in the register itself, you will simply execute the instruction. After executing the instructions, you immediately initialize the sequence counter with 0. You will initialize the sequential counter with 0. Now comes the another part. If D7 is equal to 0, we will call it as a memory reference instruction. Again, in this case also, we will check the status of I, because sometimes in memory instruction you can use two types of addressing modes. One is a direct addressing mode and another one is indirect addressing mode. So again you have to check the status of I. If I is equal to 0, see the previous class lectures, if I is equal to 0, we will assume that it is a direct addressing mode. In such a case, the address field contains the actual address of the data. So with that, you can directly execute the instruction. If D7 is equal to 0, then it is called a memory reference instruction. If I is equal to 1, we will call it as indirect addressing mode. In this addressing mode, we have to calculate the actual address. That is calculated by, again by accessing the same address location specified by the address register, and again it is transferred to same address register. After doing that, again we will execute the instruction. Once you know the exact location, actually for each execute instruction, again we need to write the binary operations. For simplicity, we will write like this. We will write in the next class. So again, this will happen at T3 clock cycle. If I is equal to 0, we will call it as a direct addressing mode. In direct addressing mode, since the address is directly available in the address field of IR register, at T3 clock pulse, you will not do anything. That means after completion of T3 clock cycle, at T4 clock cycle only, the instruction is executed. After the instruction is executed, immediately sequence counter is initialized with 0. So now, whatever the instruction may be, after completing the instruction, after completing the execution of instruction, current instruction, we need to fetch the next, instruction. So this is done by going like this. So like this, all the steps are executed sequentially until all the instructions in the user programs are finished. So like this, instruction execution will be carried out. Our computer doesn't know anything. Simply at appropriate clock pulses, control signals are generated. Depending upon the control signals, the instructions are executed sequentially in different phases. At T0, T1, fetch the instruction phase will be executed. At T2, decoding phase will be executed. At T3, clock pulse, address calculation and operand fetch is calculated. At the fourth clock cycle only, actual instruction execution is start. Once the instruction execution is completed, again you will come to the top of the loop. That means next instruction will be executed. This will be repeated until all the instructions in the program are executed. This is how computers are processing the instructions sequentially. Now we will see what is happening at T4 clock pulse. If you observe carefully, the register instruction and IO instruction, they will compute the instruction execution at T3 clocks itself. Whereas memory reference instruction, they need extra clock pulse. So now we'll see one by one. For register reference instruction, again we have to define the micro operations. This time the micro operation is different for different instructions. Let us say, for example, it is CLA. For CLA, when it has to be executed, register reference instruction, it should be executed only at T3 clock pulse, and at the same time the code assigned to this instruction, if it appears, then only you need to perform the operation. So let us suppose the binary code corresponding to this is, say for example, zero, one, one, something like this. That means these values represents bit 12, bit 13, bit 14. Bit 12, bit 13, bit 14. I hope you understand. When this condition is satisfied, then only you will execute this instruction. That means for these instructions also, you have to define the opcode. So this is our condition. This is our condition. When the condition is true, you need to execute the following micro operations. Then only CLA execution will be over at T3 clock cycle. When T3 is equal to 1 and the binary value, let us suppose it is, let me assume that it is the binary opcode value for CLA is 011. So if both these conditions are true, then only you will execute the following micro operations. For CLA, what are the micro operations? CLA means you need to initialize the accumulator with zero value. That means, what is the logic diagram? If you are having the accumulator EAC like this, we already studied one of the control pin for accumulator is clear. So what you have to do? T3, let us suppose you represent the bit 12, 13, 14 as B12, B13, B14 like this. Then whenever T3 and B12 should be in complement form, and then B13, B14 should be in normal form. B13, should be in normal form. Should be in normal form, and you take a AND gate, multi-input AND gate, and you connect this value to CLR pin. That's it. So whenever these control pins T3, D12, D13, D14 are takes the values of 1, 0, 1, 1 respectively, then the AND gate will produce 1. This will trigger the EAC value. When this value will be triggered means it depends upon the opcode value. So therefore, This is the control logic circuit. Logic circuit for CLA instruction. This is a control logic circuit for CLA instruction. Similarly, you can write, you can design so many things. So this is one such example. This is one such example. Similarly, you have to take all the instructions. For all the instructions, you have to take the condition. You have to find out the conditions based on the binary values assigned to it, and correspondingly draw the logic circuit. This logic circuit we will call it as a control logic. Likewise, you have to draw the logic circuit for all instructions or for all registers or all the components, and that whole thing, it will form the control unit, that core unit. I hope you understand. Next comes memory reference instruction. Reference instruction. This is also same thing. You take any memory reference instruction, for example, add. So we already studied the add instruction. So in add instruction, the content of accumulator and the memory operand will be added, and the result is again stored in accumulator. If there is a overflow, it will be stored in E. So let us first write the micro operations. Memory reference instruction. We take one simple example, add instruction. For this add instruction, let us define the micro operation. The micro operation is something like this. Let us suppose we assume that this add instruction is belonging to indirect addressing mode. In such a case, what are the micro operations? The contents of EAC will be added to the memory content of address, and you will get the overflow. If there is a overflow, you will store it in E flag. All these should be executed at T4 clock cycle. Please see the diagram. Memory reference instruction. Here we assume that it is an indirect addressing mode. So at T4 clock cycle, you have to execute. At the same time, I should be 1 and D7 should be 0. So you can write the condition something like this. D7 should be 0 means it should be in complement form. D7 should be in complement form. And then D7 should be in complement form. And then and I should be in normal form. I should take value 1. And T4 clock pulse should be active. When this condition is satisfied, you will execute the micro operation. This is the condition. When this condition is true, these two micro operations are executed. Please see this. So corresponding to this also, we'll draw the logic circuit. Logic circuit. So you can complete the logic circuit corresponding to this. It's a very simple thing. So this completes about memory reference instruction. Next comes input output instruction. Input output instruction. For input output instruction, the case is different. Input output instruction. For input output instruction execution, we need to take the help of the two flag inputs. Let us draw the diagram. Let us suppose this is a printer. RX receiver interface. We already discussed about the output register and then accumulator, INPR input register, transmitter interface, and then keyboard. Let us understand this diagram, then we will discuss about input output instruction execution. This is our accumulator. We will have flag input, flag output. So if you see from this diagram, if a keyboard data has to be entered into the CPU, first of all it has to be entered through this transmitter interface. From this transmitter interface, it has to be entered into the input register, INPR. The connection in this, it will be in the form of serial communication. The data transmission between INPR and AC and AC to output register will be in parallel transmission, parallel data transmission. And the data transmission from output register to the printer, it will be in serial transmission mode. So coming to input output instruction, whenever a data has to be sent from the keyboard to the CPU, that means first it will send the data to INPR in serial mode. So if INPR register collects all the 8 bits, that means if input register gets the data from the keyboard, after getting complete data, immediately the flag input FGI, it will be set equal to 1. So whenever the flag input is 1, is detected by our control unit, immediately the data will be transferred from input register to the AC. Similarly, whenever the output has to be sent from CPU to the printer in this direction, the contents of AC will be first transferred to the output register. After fully transmitting the data to output register, immediately the F0 will be set equal to 0. When F0 is equal to 0, output flag is equal to 0 means the printer gets the data from the output register slowly. When the printer finally completes in getting the data from output register, then automatically F0 FGO is set equal to 1. If F0 is set equal to 1, that means the data has already been sent to the printer. That means output register is ready to accept new data. So the content of AC is again transferred to output register. So in this way, with the help of flag input and flag output, we can transmit the data to and from the input output devices with the help of accumulator. So in short, if you want to transmit the data or receive the data, means it will be available in the accumulator only. You see the case of input case, similarly for output case also. If you want to transmit any data to output device, it should be made available in the AC. From the AC, it should be there transferred to the output register. When you transfer the data to output register, immediately FGO is set equal to 0. F0 is set equal to 0. Then output starts detecting that and it gets the data from the output register. If you want to send the data, very simple. If the input has to be sent to the accumulator, the transmitter interface, it will check the FGI. If the FGI is equal to 0, then it starts the transmitting the data. As soon as the input register is full with new data, immediately the transmitter interface, it will inform the accumulator or CPU by setting the FGI is equal to 1. So in output instructions, these are all very important. So in short, if FGI is equal to 1, then the contents of INPR register is transferred to accumulator, and then immediately flag input is set to 0. After data is transferred to accumulator, immediately FGI is set equal to 0. If FGO is equal to 1 means, that means you have to transfer the contents of accumulator to the output register, and immediately flag output is set equal to 0. This is what we are doing here. This is what is happening in the input output instruction execution. Once you understand this, now we can go to our register reference instruction. Now we will set, for each register reference instruction, we will set the micro operations. Say for example, input operation. So this operation, it will transfer the data from input register to AC. So corresponding to this, the micro operation is INPR to accumulator. Since accumulator is a 16-bit word, you will transfer the data of INPR to first 8 positions only. We already discussed the size of INPR register is only 8 bits. The remaining bit positions of AC are filled with zeros, followed by what is the next micro operation? FGI is set equal to 0. These two micro operations are performed when the following conditions holds true. What is the condition? Please see the diagram. Please see the flowchart. In this flowchart, register reference instructions are executed when D7 is equal to 1 and I is equal to 0 and T3 is activated. Sorry, this is register. Actually, we are dealing about input-output instructions. Input-output instructions has to be executed when D7 is equal to 1 and I is equal to 1 and T3 is activated. Therefore, when D7 is activated and I bit is 1 and T3 is activated and the corresponding binary code, so I will write in a neat manner, D7 into I into T3 into corresponding bit positions. Say for example, B12, B13, B14. Is it right? It is not. Tell me. Here we are referring to register reference instructions. You see the previous diagram. In register reference instructions, you need to analyze. You see the instruction format. This is our instruction format. This is 14, 13, 12, and this is 15. 7 is equal to 1. You need to analyze 0 to 11 bits. That means B11, B10, and so on up to B0. Therefore, depending upon B0, B11, you need to execute these two micro operations. I hope you understand this. It's very simple. Whenever the conditions of all this is true, then only you will execute these two micro operations. If these two micro operations are executed, means this input, this a small mistake. Here we are dealing about input output reference instruction. So this input output instruction will be executed. Let us say for example, I will write in hexadecimal format. Say for example, the binary code format for this is hexadecimal format. So whenever 810 is the, let us suppose 810 is the hexadecimal code for this input output instruction INP then automatically when D7 is equal to 1 and I is equal to 1, T3 is equal to 1, this condition is satisfied 8, 10, then automatically these two instructions are executed. Likewise, you can write for output instruction. Output means the data from AC is transferred to the output register. That means something like this. You write the first condition here and then T3 B 11. When this true, when all these are true, then you need to execute AC to OUTR. We already told that the content of accumulator is 16 bit long, so you need to transfer lower bytes from 0 to 7. After transferring is over, immediately you need to assign 0 to FGO. So in this way you have to define the micro operations for all input output instructions, skip on input flag, skip on output flag, interrupt enable, interrupt enable off. For all these input output instructions we have to define the conditions. You have to define the conditions just like this. For each conditions, draw the logic circuit and finally simplify it. So in this way the control circuit is drawn for each and every operation, for each and every instructions in the instruction set. This is one way of designing. Even though it is not optimizer method, we'll discuss the optimizer method later. As of now, just you should understand that you need to design the logic circuit for each and every instruction in the instruction set so that control signals are generated. When the control signals are generated, these logic circuits gets activated and performs appropriate operations.